A big thank you to Marshall Music for sponsoring us this beautiful microphone.
Hi guys, welcome back to our YouTube channel. As you know, I'm called Kitchen Gassam. I'm the resident YouTuber for the Queen's Students Physician Society 2021. And today's video is really quite an exciting one because we are actually meeting up with some doctors that graduated during the time of apartheid. So today's video is all about becoming a doctor as a person of color during apartheid. And you know, we're celebrating Youth Day soon. So by the time you guys see this video, it'll be Youth Day. And what better way to highlight Youth Day than to look at how the challenges that people of color used to face as they tried, as they went through their journey to becoming the doctors that they are today. So today's video is going to be fascinating. We've got two doctors that we're going to be interviewing. We've got Dr. Genevieve Ephraim and we've got Dr. Alfred Makuben. I'm going to be interviewing them, just getting to know a little bit about what it was like going to medical school as a person of color in apartheid South Africa. The struggles that they faced, you know, the different injustices, the different prejudices, the discrimination that they felt, but also their experiences. So I think this video promises to be an extremely awesome video with some stories that, you know, I myself am so excited to hear. So come on, join us as we go along to meet some of these doctors, and I'm sure it's going to be a great video. Please don't forget to like, share, subscribe, comment, you know, in the comment section below. And yeah guys, enjoy this video and happy Youth Day. Let's celebrate the youth. So I'm here with this incredible doctor, Dr. Ephraim. How are you doing, doctor?
I'm fine, thanks, Ryan. How are you?
I'm good. So this incredible doctor, I actually shadowed her in my second year of university. She's an ophthalmologist here at Sunning Hill Hospital and also at Garden City Hospital. So how's that been going?
Yeah, it's been picking up again. We had quite a wobble last year with the pandemic, obviously. Ophthalmology is essentially an elective specialty, so patient numbers have been very, very reduced, but we're recovering and we're hopeful that things will start to get better.
So which university did you go to?
So I started, I was at Wits all my life. I started in 1985.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
So how was that?
A long time ago.
Yeah.
It was back in the bad old days when things are a lot different to how they are now.
Yeah.
So it was a completely different experience, I think, to what medical students have now.
Yeah.
The demographic of students in my class was completely different to what it would be.
Yeah, it's probably the opposite.
The opposite actually. Of what it is now, yeah.
Sure.
So something like maybe 20% people of color and 80% white people. And that trend was throughout my years at medical school. And only really started changing, I think, once the change in the government happened after 1994.
I think in terms of university, what was that like? What was your experience in varsity like?
Okay. So look, first of all, just getting in was a challenge for us. There was a very big divide between black students and white students. Mm. And just from the point of actually getting in, in fact, the year before I applied, so in 1984, that was the year where they did away with something called ministerial consent for black students. Mm-hmm. So even if you passed very well, and if you had what was required for you to enter university, you couldn't do that. You had to still apply to the Minister of Education and get consent from the Minister of Education to apply to university. Mm-hmm. In the year that I got into medicine, and I happened to be very fortunate that I got directly into first year medicine, there were only two of us. It was myself and the current dean of the medical faculty, Professor Marty.
Oh, wow, yeah.
The two of us got directly into medicine in 1985.
Sure.
So there were lots of other people of color who eventually graduated with us, but they had to do BSc or some other mm-hmm. degree and applied to get into medicine at a later stage.
Yeah, yeah.
So they joined the medical class maybe like in second year or third year, depending on how lucky they were in their applications.
So you actually touched about the fact that you lived in Indonesia
mm-hmm.
And you were from there. So how did that work? Did you have to transport yourself to school daily?
Yes, so that was another big aspect of the struggle of being a medical student back in those days. The traveling was a big part of the hardship. A lot of us were not from an affluent society. We didn't own our own vehicle. So transport using carpools, and that was not really an option, especially in the first year.
Mm.
And we had to use public transport, which was a bus service that ran from Lanesia to main campus, because first year was at main campus.
Mm.
And this essentially consisted of a 2-hour commute in the morning.
What?
Because what had to happen is there was one bus, it would start at one end of the township and travel throughout the township, picking up people at various spots. So by the time it made its way through the township, there was an hour that had passed.
Yeah.
And then the traffic from Lanesia to Johannesburg would mean another hour.
Hmm.
And this was a thing that was repeated in the afternoon. So we would usually have to take the last bus from campus, because as medical students, we had lectures in the morning and we had laboratories in the afternoon that ran till 5.
Hmm.
And the last bus would leave between 5:30 and 6 o'clock. So often you got home when it was dark after 7 and you'd have to do your work, do your studying, prepare for the next day, get to bed, get some rest, and be up and ready early the next morning to get back to campus.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, most people now, if you think of your first year at campus, it's your first year of being social, having fun, going to parties.
Yeah.
I mean, having your youth, you know, and enjoying your youth. I think a lot of that passed us by, because some of us were there on bursaries.
Yeah.
Some of us were there on scholarships. That's how we managed to pay.
Mm.
There were very few who were actually paying for their university education. And the onus was on us to make sure that we passed.
Mm.
So you had no choice. You had to do the work.
Mm.
You could not complain. You could not take the easy road. And there were people who struggled, and there were people who didn't make it.
Mm.
But those of us who did make it, it wasn't an easy road.
Yeah,
I have to admit,
it was
really difficult.
Mm. You also mentioned about funding and how a lot of students were in some form of scholarship or bursary.
I think virtually all the non-white students were on some kind of a funding basis. I myself actually was on an engineering bursary.
Oh, really?
Yes, a really nice woman who worked there, and she said, well, we don't have any medical bursaries left this year, but we do have a spare engineering bursary, and I'll have to get permission from the person in charge, you know, the sponsor. And he was kind enough to allow me to have his bursary. And he actually sponsored me throughout medical school.
Wow. I wanted to also ask, what laws of those days do you think hindered your experience from being sort of a little bit more equal to those of white students?
It all goes back to the fact that we were still in the height of apartheid.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
And we could not move as freely as we would have liked to. I mean, traveling was not easy, okay? I mean, you had to stick to the transport that was allocated to you. I mean, you couldn't be free to go into any public facility. All these things were restricted to people of color. And I think just the same restrictions that apply to everyone apply to us at the university.
What was the clinical space like in those days, and which hospitals were you allowed to work at?
Yeah, so that's a very important thing to discuss. So when we entered our clinical years, which was in fourth year, so it was quite different to how you people do it now.
Mm-hmm.
We did three pre-clinical years where we really didn't have much patient contact. And then in fourth year, we would go into the hospitals and we would have patient contact, and in the afternoons we would go back to medical school for lectures. So we were all given the choice in fourth year of being the so-called rotators and non-rotators. And rotation, if you were a rotator, what that meant was that you would be able to see patients in all the academic hospitals. So those hospitals were Baragwanath, the Joburg Gin, Charlotte Mackenzie at the moment, Helen Joseph, which in those days was J.G. Stradom, and then we had Heilbron Hospital as well, which now no longer exists.
Yeah.
Okay, so those were the four academic teaching hospitals, and they were all busy hospitals.
Mm.
But Charlotte and J.G. or Helen were white hospital, white only hospitals.
Okay.
Barra and Heilbron were black hospitals for black people. If you wanted to rotate through all those hospitals, as a black student, you were allowed to do that. But in the white hospitals, so at the Joburg Gin and at Helen Joseph, you would not be allowed in the obstetrics and gynae wards.
Okay.
So that was the rule.
Yeah.
I mean, as ludicrous as that sounds, that was the rule. And our question was, why? So there was no answer to that. It just was, that was the rule.
Yeah.
You could go through the hospital, you would be allowed in all the wards except in the obstetrics and gynae ward. And clearly this was actually very insulting and disrespectful to us as students.
Mm.
And we chose to be non-rotators.
Mm.
And we said that we would choose not to go into the white hospitals. Our rotations would be restricted to the black hospitals, where we allowed to go into all the wards.
How did you guys get to these hospitals? Was there a bus service at the university?
So there was a bus service that would go from medical school and take you to the hospital and bring you back. But by the time we got into fourth year, a lot of us had managed to get into some kind of a carpool.
Mm.
Okay. Because it was impossible for us to travel from Lanesia, go all the way to medical school, get there on time to get onto the bus and then get to the hospital. Because
mm.
a lot of us had to go to Barra.
Mm.
And so traveling back to Barra, back in the traffic, it was such a waste of time.
Yeah.
So if you were living in Lanesia, it was actually quite easy to get to Barra. It was about a 15-minute drive.
What was the experience like with your lecturers? How did you navigate, the entrenched racism within a lot of the people?
You see, I think I was quite fortunate being a non-rotator. We worked in hospitals that were, even the white professors, the white doctors who worked in those hospitals were generally from that class of people who were not racist.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, they chose to work in a place where, they felt comfortable. The other possible place where the racism reared its head a bit more was actually between the students themselves.
I can imagine, yeah.
Rather than between the teachers and the students.
Mm.
I think the racism aspect of it certainly was there between fellow students. That's where I was more aware of it. We were going through a very difficult period at that time. So we're talking now 1991.
Mm-hmm.
So that was just 3 years before the big change, 1994. So there was a lot of political unrest here in Johannesburg. It was the time of the Boipatong massacre, all kinds of political problems happening. But it was also an exciting time. It was the time that they released Mandela, and it was the first time that there was really hope that things were going to change.
Mm.
And we could feel it. It was almost tangible in the air. I remember that when the day that they released him from Victor Verster, we were actually on one of our community health blocks somewhere in one of the rural areas. And it was just, I will never forget that day. There was just a sense of excitement and joy that it was far reaching. We were far out in this little rural village, and even there, everyone was so excited.
Sure.
It was really a monumental occasion. And that was generally the sense everywhere in the country. I mean, I don't know if there's anything more for me to say about that. It still was difficult to get into the specialty that you wanted to get in.
Mm.
It was definitely still more skewed towards white entrance than black entrance. And it was difficult to get into ophthalmology. I mean, there were many people who advised me not to even try. there were many people who said, you will never get in. Mm. It's out of the question. It's one of the most difficult specialties to get in. And I suppose you just have to be stubborn and set your mind on something and keep trying.
Yeah. But anyway, thank you so much.
It's been a pleasure.
So insightful, and listening to you speak just every single time, I just become so excited for the future. New motivation, like new juice flowing through me,
yes,
just to, you know, keep going and keep pushing for exactly what it is that I eventually want to do. But also not being resistant to change, you know.
No.
So yeah, you're such an inspiration, and
I really appreciate you
taking some time out of your busy schedule.
It's a great pleasure. I hope that the interview or what I've said resonates with someone somewhere.
No,
and inspires someone somewhere.
I'm sure it will inspire, but it inspires me so much how you can be such an incredible doctor, person, human being. And you went through all of that you went through.
And there are many of us who went through it. And all of us, I mean, now your new dean is one of my my friends.
Yeah.
And I think now the medical school is in such a strong place with him in charge. And you people are just so lucky, you know, to be able to learn from someone like that, to have someone like that captaining your ship. So you're all going to do well. And Wits Medical School is still one of the best, I think.
Yeah.
So it's just such an incredible, you know, teaching ground for our students.
Yeah.
Fine, and you, Ryan?
I'm good. Thank you so much for agreeing to be part of this interview. It's really such an exciting interview. We're approaching Youth Day on Wednesday coming up. And it's just such a celebration of what the people, what our people have done for us, the sacrifices that so many people have made for us to be in what we can say a better South Africa than what was there in the past. So in this video, we're basically highlighting becoming a doctor as a person of color during apartheid. So how was that experience for you?
It was a journey that one couldn't imagine. I took a gap year because of funding. You know, there was no funding. So I took a gap year and got a job in the Val as a migrant worker for a year. Accumulated some few runs that managed to take me to the University of Natal, what you call today UKZN. And thereafter, June came and some scholarships rolled in, and I finished the year. The university also applied what we call needs analysis today. And they gave me a 55% fee reduction because of the circumstances. They check your parents' income, your background, how much you earn from the household where you come from. And they give us a 55%, those who are not fully funded and who qualified for that reduction.
So you said that you went to the University of Natal. What you call today UKZN?
Yeah, University of Natal.
So how was that experience? How was the university there?
Growing up in Pretoria, I wanted to be out of Gauteng. So the University of Natal at the time, UKZN, had an exclusively black medical faculty.
Oh, okay.
Because it was established by an English missionary, Alan Taylor, because he saw the need to educate people of color to study medicine, because they were poorly represented in the medical field. That is African, Indian, and colored. And it was part of the then exclusively white University of Natal, but the medical faculty was blacks.
What was that experience like?
It brought people together because the likes of Biko went through it, or they didn't finish. Steve Biko, the likes of Mampela Rampela went through it.
Yeah.
The likes of Prof. Mayosi.
Yeah, Prof. Mayosi. Yeah.
Yeah, went through it.
Yeah.
So like some of the greatest people, the greatest names in medicine went through like that university. So basically, you as a person of color, as a black person, you know, in those days, there were a lot of laws, and you even already mentioned the Group Areas Act, which meant that you couldn't like reside very close to the university or in the area where the university was. What laws do you feel hindered your experience as a black person, that made your experience as a black person becoming a doctor different to that of a white person?
The type of education that you are given, primary and secondary, lacked depth to the extent that when you reached first year university, you're struggling to pass the basic sciences. You had to put a lot of effort. That's one. And the other thing is, there was what you call, and I'm not sure people are familiar with this, ministerial consent to be granted to a black student to study at a white university then. So me being from Pretoria, UP was my closest. The Wits was the second. Then I applied to Wits to study medicine there. And at that time, F.W. de Klerk was the Minister of Education who was supposed to give that consent for me to study at Wits, and he declined.
Sure.
And I had to settle for University of Natal. So the university catered for us adequately in that it organized, you know, kumbis, what you'd call to the microbuses, to drive, to take us to clinics. So there was never a lack of transportation. And during our final year, sixth year, they used to organize accommodation next to the hospital so that in case you can't go back to RAS, then there's what you call Impala House residence for family clinical students.
Basically, you're saying that you weren't allowed to touch white patients, so you didn't come into contact with them. So I think, like, how was that sort of transition once, you know, I guess apartheid started fizzling away? Did you ever have to then start becoming more a doctor that interacted with white patients as well?
Yeah. It sort of, with time, it sort of melts away in that you had to to attend to people of all colors, all hues.
So, you know, when you started interacting with these white patients, did you ever have experienced any difficulties just with the patients themselves? Like, did they treat you as a black person like weirdly? Did they undermine your intelligence, you know?
Yeah. You felt that you were being assessed subtly.
You know, at these hospitals that you had to work at during your medical school career, what was the patient load like? Do you think you guys had a very hectic patient load, specifically because you were the black students, you know, so you were the ones really interacting with the black patients? Do you think like your patient load would differ to that of someone at a white university?
So the patient load in this country was almost the same between graduates. It's just that before 1990, the bed allocation of the ICU was different in that you find that there were more ICU beds in white hospitals than in black hospitals.
It's just, it's incredible. Every time I hear the stories of the past, I'm just amazed by what people, young people, did for this country, you know, and how young people are actually responsible for the, you know, young people back then, you know, are actually responsible for where the country is today. So I just want to, number one, thank you for that sacrifice that you made to become a doctor, to give hope to people that are black to become doctors, to know that it is possible for a black person to be a doctor and to be the best doctor they can be.
I've heard disadvantaged black academics to the core. It was never a rosy picture. It was hard to ascend the ladders which you deservedly ascended, but you're never recognized.
Dr. Makubela, I really, really appreciate you taking time out of your day to speak to us, you know, young black students of today, about what it looked like, you know, in like a couple of years back, as a person of color, as a black person, trying to become a doctor then was almost impossible. There's not a lot, you know, that can say that with all of the challenges that were brought against you, starting from school to the point of graduating from university, just challenge after challenge after challenge after challenge, trying to stop you from realizing your dream. And, you know, whenever I look at a black doctor that comes from that era, I look at that doctor and I'm like, wow, you know, I'm amazed. And it just pushes us, it pushes me, pushes a lot of other black students to keep going, you know, to keep pushing, to keep to change the narrative, you know, to basically show the world that we are capable of whatever it is that we want to do. And it's because of your generation and the people that came before you that you mentioned that pushed you that we are here today. So I really, really appreciate you for taking time out of your day to speak to us, to just shed some light into what your experience was as a medical student.
My pleasure, my pleasure. And you are always welcome to ask for anything that you need clarity on. I mean, people have become doctors, why not you? No, my pleasure. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Okay.
Did you know that smokers reduce their life expectancy by 11 minutes per cigarette?